Welcome to Talking Africa here on Arise News, a special weekly edition of Africa Wrap, where we take time to reflect on the fortunes and affairs of the emerging continent within its own countries and across the world in an hour of conversation with African commentators and thought leaders. I'm Charles Onyegolu, and this is Talking Africa. He's the man who would be president. Nigeria's opposition leader, Muhammadu Buhari, is, by all accounts, running neck and neck with incumbent Goodluck Jonathan as the postponed presidential election polling day looms large. Voting takes place on March 28th. But this week, the All Progressives candidate wasn't slugging it out on the campaign trail in Nigeria. He brought his campaign to London. He spoke at the internationally renowned Chatham House in a wide-ranging speech. He promised much and was uncompromising of his criticism of the ruling PDP's tenure in charge of his nation. Well, in a moment, we'll debate what he had to say, but first, let's have a listen to some of it.
Our soldiers have neither received the necessary support nor the required incentives to tackle this problem. The government has also failed in any effort towards a multidimensional response to this problem, leading to a situation in which we have now become dependent on our neighbors to come to our rescue. A growth that on account of mismanagement, profligacy, and corruption has not translated to human development or shared prosperity. A development economist once said, three questions should be asked about a country's development. One, what is happening to poverty? Two, what is happening to unemployment? And three, what is happening to inequality? The answers to these three questions in Nigeria show that the current administration has created two economies in one country. A sorry tale of two nations. One economy for a few who have so much in their tiny islands of prosperity, and the other economy for the many who have so little in their vast ocean of misery. I take responsibility for whatever happened under my watch. I cannot change the past, but I can change the present and the future. Yes, sir. So before you is a former military ruler and a converted Democrat who is ready to operate under democratic norms and is subjecting himself to the rigors of democratic election for the fourth time.
Let us have the first question over on, right at the back there.
How do you propose to grow the Nigerian economy, considering the fact that the global economy is still in recession? Would you propose to grant an amnesty to, general amnesty to Boko Haram?
We want to secure Nigeria. We must have the time to help collect enough intelligence to make sure that those that we got are given the chance in civil courts to be properly prosecuted.
Nigeria was outstanding in leading in the Ebola crisis, and you showed us what you're capable of. I'm just wondering, in your leadership, how you're planning to carry that forward in terms of strengthening our health systems in Nigeria, and particularly focusing on women and children, who are the most vulnerable in the population.
Well, luckily, the governor of Rivers State is here. she brought me Amechi. It is him and the governor of Lagos State that experienced Ebola. And they did extremely well by moving fast enough. They didn't wait for the central government to make sure that they have done something about it. And Nigeria was certified Ebola free. So we are lucky that we had very competent And by fabulous coincidence, APC governors in place to kill Ebola. Yeah. So I think health is one of the areas that have been allowed in those 16 years we refer to really deteriorate. The life, especially in the rural area, is pathetic. And because of lack of basic facilities in the rural areas that aggravate the movement of able-bodied bodies to population centers, and that increase the rate of crime because of lack of jobs, lack of facilities, lack of even basic thing to survive. So I think an APC government has done a lot of studies, and our manifesto has consciously looked at this, and we will try as much as possible to make sure that infrastructure led by power, the social services led by education and health, as rapidly as possible given to the people.
You made mention of the fact that you would disarm Boko Haram and that you would arm the Nigerian army to be able to deal with, combat Boko Haram. But it is also widely reported in the Nigerian dailies that you once said that an attack against Boko Haram was an attack against the North. And I wondered, sir, if you therefore armed the army to then attack Boko Haram and destroy their properties, would that not still be an attack against the North?
No, I assure you that people generally in the North are fighting the Boko Haram in their own way, bypassing intelligence to the law enforcement agents about their movements and so on. They are doing their best to fight Boko Haram because they are the biggest casualties. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And our thanks to Chatham House here in London for that coverage of Muhammadu Buhari's speech. You can find out more about their international work and research by visiting their website. The address is on the screen now. So, evidence of some personal charm, there was humour, as well as policy in Muhammadu Buhari's words. But he visited London at a time when the man whose job he wants, Nigeria's president, Goodluck Jonathan, has enjoyed some spectacular success with allies in the battle against Boko Haram. In recent days, much territory regained, groups of Islamist fighters routed, hundreds of them killed, and weapons and training camps seized and destroyed with waves of airstrikes as well as ground assaults. General Buhari, a former military leader of Nigeria, is trading much on his security credentials in this election. So how does that success for President Jonathan affect his chances of winning the vote? Well, here to discuss all of this with me now are the health expert and Africa analyst Dorcas Gwata and the security and terrorism expert Temi Tope Olode. Thank you very much indeed to both of you for coming in. Dorcas, you were there at Chatham House. First, give us your impressions of the man. It was a tame audience. It was a respectful and unchallenging, pretty much. It's fair to say that, you know, he came across in a way that perhaps suited the audience that was watching him. What was your take?
Do you know, Charles, Buhari came to London to make a case for himself. He didn't come here to bash Jonathan Goodman. He came to make a case of his leadership, and he impressed us. And he probably swayed a number of voters who were kind of swinging this way and that way. He was extremely humble. He was very grounded. He had a handle on the issues, not just of Boko Haram, but a handle on what the issues are for Nigeria for today, not when he was running for office some time ago. So I was really impressed. I loved the line that he said, "I'm responsible for what happened on my watch." By saying so and doing so, he's taking responsibility.
But I remember just a few weeks ago, you were sitting at this
yes.
same spot, and your impressions of him were extremely low. What is it that you saw this time that made you change your mind?
Political maturity. He just appeared experienced. He's been there and done that. He's got a handle on the issues in terms of what people are concerned about. It's not just about Boko Haram or a big player in this. It's about the economy. It's about the youth. He addressed the youth, and not very many African presidents do that, let's be fair. They seem to be quite sort of removed. But he appeared grounded and ready to take on the issues. And there was an atmosphere in the whole Chatham House, which you don't see very often when African leaders come to talk here. Often you get a diaspora launching on them and are very, very aggressive. We're all contained. He contained us by reassuring the issues. Whether he can deliver or not, I'm not sure, but right. we felt reassured.
Okay, now Temi Tope, yeah. General Buhari spoke of being a converted Democrat. I mean, looking at his sort of past track record during his military dictatorship, lots of arrests, yep. lots of people locked up without trial, some people even shot.
Yes.
Are you convinced when he says that he's a converted Democrat?
There are two schools of thought on this. People that believe that he's not because those records stand, you know, for themselves, and there's others that believe that he should be given that opportunity because, you know, he's gone through the process and he used this opportunity to actually make that case that he's gone through the process, he's not, you know, picked up arm, he's gone through the court, to the Supreme Court, in order to show he's been there for 20 months, he's been there for a year, and was trying to explain to the audience that he's a reform man. Yes, I was a military leader before and I accept my responsibility under those, under that term, and now I'm going through the democratic process. It will win some. There are others that will not be convinced by that because the statements that are accredited to him, which are even of recent, and those are the kind of challenges that we still have in Africa where, you know, people say things without thinking about the repercussion of those things that they've said. However, what has improved from 2011 to 2014 is that he's becoming more and more careful in terms of his utterances. So right. even when the election was postponed, instead of going out and saying things that he need not to say, he said, no, let's not go through that. And then he even went on to say that, you know, we've signed the, you know, Abuja treaty and I'm going to abide by that and let's just wait, just make sure that there's a free and fair election.
Right, so a growing sense of responsibility yeah. and perhaps decorum that, you know, I am a presidential candidate and I've got to watch what I say.
Yes.
But he also spoke, Dorcas, as any would-be president yes. would, of change.
Yes.
He talked about education, health, which is an area that's, you know, particular to you, job
Indeed.
Creation, pensions and so
sure.
on. What was your impression?
You know, Charles, he seemed to have a handle on those things. He didn't wait to be asked about these
Yeah, but you
issues.
Asked him a question about health. What yeah. did? What was his response, and how do you sort of assess his response?
You know, as a health expert, he relied on his team in the front. And I think inside him, he was thinking, oh, my God, thank God there's a guy in front who can sort of back me up on the health. Still, he's not a health expert. Does he have a handle on the issues? I felt reassured. He's the main institutions that are subject for development in any country are education and health and, you know, and the army and all that sort of stuff. He seemed to have a handle on that. But one point is very clear, Charles. What made him excellent today, if he is excellent, is not necessarily his excellence. It's Jonathan's failures. Jonathan has failed to deliver, and what oppositions do, and when they do them really well, is go into that niche and find a trail. And he's shining today because Jonathan has failed.
Do you agree that Jonathan has failed, Kevin?
Actually, I feel Jonathan has done a lot because we have to give credit for what he's done. I think he's Jonathan's failure is due to bad advice. When the Chibok girls were picked up, one of the things I said was, you know, the president could fly over Chibok. He doesn't need to land there. He could fly over Chibok, look at those issues. He could get all the parents away from that environment, put them in a different room and do all the
So practices. His PR was not very good.
It wasn't very good.
But let's talk about the other pressing issues.
Yeah.
Because she talked about, you know, education, health, job creation, and so on and so forth. General Buhari said funding, and of course you've got to look at it in the context of the fall in oil prices,
yeah.
which means falling revenues
yes.
for the
yes.
government,
yeah.
and where that money is going to come from. And General Buhari suggested that he would plug the holes. And of course that's an obvious reference to yeah. corruption tackling corruption. He talked about that there'd be one set of books in his leadership, which is an obvious reference to, you know, the former central bank governor talking about different accounts to which monies are deposited. I mean, how much of an issue do you think corruption is in these elections coming up in Nigeria?
It is the key, and I think one of the things he's selling is credential, is that I'm not corrupt, and I think that's the reason why he's got so many followers. But I think it's important to listen to his speech very carefully. Somebody in the audience asked about who are you going to go after? Is the people from the 60s down? And he said, as far as I'm concerned, his speech is very clear that it will start from when he gets into government. So he's not doing any witch hunting. He said, clearly, I'm going to make sure that there are no corrupt people in my government. And then the laws are there, enabling laws are there to ensure that people are not corrupt.
Well, I would imagine that that would make a lot of people exceedingly nervous. Because in his political party, in his party, APC, a lot of them crossed over from the PDP. A lot of them, there are allegations pending against them of massive corruption. So it's going to be a little bit difficult to see how he's actually going to go against the same people who funded his campaign.
And that's the reason why what he said was very clear, that his corruption campaign, if I read it well, will start from when he gets into government, which is from his own party, his own cabinet.
Right.
So not going back to witch hunt people. Personally, I would have loved him to have an kind of an amnesty to say, you know what, if you stole money, you know, secretly return some money back and things like that. If he's not going after, you know, past, you know, going back to say, you know, you stole money, then most of the people that will go against him now will, you know, will be relaxed in terms of, you know, saying, okay, let's give this guy a chance because he's not coming after us.
Now, Dorcas, I met him, you know, a couple of months ago, had a long breakfast with him, had a wide-ranging interview. What I thought was interesting about him was the fact that there were so many people who he jailed without trial. No accusation, no trial, no charge, some of them for up to 18 months, sometimes for longer. Yet many of those people that I talk to in Nigeria say they're going to vote for him. What do you think is behind that sort of confidence that they seem to have in him?
I wonder if the fact that he's just taken responsibility for his past. People have passed, and his is quite heavy, and is taking some responsibility to it. There could be a number of factors, Charles. It may be that they are not, their option for voting for Jonathan is not even an option. So their options are limited down to him. But the wider question is, are we seeing a rehabilitated leader and a refreshed leader who's looking back at things? We can take some confidence in that he is reflecting on this. Not many African leaders do, and I think that I'm encouraged by that. Whether he can deliver or not, again, is an issue.
Okay, time now for a very short break, but do please stay with us on Talking Africa. There's lots more to discuss this week, including the ongoing protests against power cuts in Ghana. We'll be asking why one of the continent's fastest growing economies is struggling to keep the lights on.
The best way to predict the future is to create it. There's a special breed of achievers out there called tomorrow's people. They imagine what will be and strive to make it happen. They refuse to wait for the future. Tomorrow bends and conforms to their ideas. At Access Bank, we share the same sentiments. Our mantra for success is simple: speed, service, and security. Tomorrow's people own the future because they keep the world turning. That is the power of taking tomorrow.
Thinking of banking in Africa? Then think Zenith, one of the biggest in Nigeria, with assets over $16 billion, listed among the 20 most influential brands in the world, and winner of Best Bank in Corporate Governance, the most customer-focused bank in Nigeria, a success built on three foundations, dedicated to people, technology, service. Zenith Bank, in your best interest.
In this part of the program, we're going to take a look at how unreliable electricity supply is causing problems in some of Africa's largest economies, bringing people onto the streets and sending big business elsewhere. In Ghana, patience has run flat as rolling power cuts bring the country to a standstill. Paul Chapman reports.
Some carried TV sets, some carried sewing machines. All who took part in this protest in Ghana's capital were united in their fury over daily power cuts hitting families and businesses alike.
The energy situation is terrible. The promises are way too much, which I'm sure nobody here can contain. From the petty trader to talk about the sub-millers, to talk about the Guineas and the rest, they are all suffering. And certainly they are laying off staff.
Ghana's power minister says there are inadequate water levels at the country's three hydroelectricity plants. The problem's been compounded by frequent breakdowns, so demand is outstripping supply. Earlier this month, the government ordered a fleet of barges with up to 1,000 megawatts of generating capacity. For hairdresser Comfort Balakinam, a solution could mean her business survives or dies.
I'll come without not working. When the customer comes, she will go. Where will I get money? Whilst we have children in the house, taking care of different things, where will I get the money to pay school fees and stuff?
The government's hoping to boost capacity by more than double to 5,000 megawatts by 2017. In the meantime, ministers say supply should improve significantly by the end of this year as more energy projects are completed.
Well, it's not just Ghana that suffers power supply issues in the emerging continent. It was South Africa's budget week this week. Higher taxes, slower growth, a downbeat outlook. And the country's finance minister told Parliament that paying for upgrades to South Africa's crumbling infrastructure will cost $3 billion.
One by one, the residents of Masakane in the northeast of South Africa go to pick up their weekly coal ration. Two wheelbarrow loads can cover a family's heating and cooking needs for a week. But despite being given the coal for free, local residents would all prefer to have electricity produced by the Duva power station just a few hundred meters away from their homes.
We don't understand why we don't have electricity when we live where the electricity is produced.
We really want electricity. We need it a lot. We have children who go to school. They have to study. But it's really difficult to study by candlelight.
The first lights in South Africa were switched on in 1881. And since the end of apartheid in 1994, around 6 million homes have been electrified. But with an aging network, poorly maintained and permanently overloaded, 15% of homes are still without electricity. In this informal settlement, only the richest residents can afford to get connected to the grid. But all of them suffer from their proximity to the burning coal.
When I cough, it's black, so I know it's the coal. I'm going to hospital because I've been coughing a lot more. My chest really hurts.
90% of South Africa's electricity is generated by coal-fired power stations. In Masakane's dry winter, coal dust coats the floors, the walls, and the furniture. Strict new air quality standards would have forced national power provider Eskom to reduce its harmful emissions. But it doesn't have the money to upgrade its stations and has asked for a delay in meeting the requirements.
This project will cost 72 billion rand. They have given us some permission to delay some of the new technologies that we want to implement on some of the power stations. They agree with us that it is part of a good plan, but currently we do not have enough money to implement those things.
Some of Masakane's residents work at the nearby mine, where they are required to wear gas masks. But back home, they have no such protection and no electricity.
Heather Scott reporting there. Let's turn to my guest for comment on this crucial issue of power supply for Ghana, for South Africa, and for many African nations at this time. Tebi Tope, I'll start with you. Demand for energy increasing across Africa at an unrivaled pace, but with infrastructure investment failing to keep up. What more needs to be done to help rising economies like Ghana and South Africa and many more to succeed?
I think it's investment. And the challenge that we have now is that the oil price is dropping, the economy is slowing down. We know the South African economy is now at 1.4%, and it's a lot of money that need to be invested into it. You know, the minister is talking about $3 billion. That's a lot of money. But, you know, people are not going to be patient about it. The fact is that they need electricity. For all walk of life, you need electricity. The businesses need it, otherwise they'll move out. The individuals need it, otherwise their business will collapse at grassroots. So it is important that government actually look into it. And I think it's not just South Africa alone. We're talking of Nigeria, we're talking of most countries, even Ghana that used to have stable electricity, that are struggling on this matter. And it's a matter of serious national concern that needs to be dealt with.
Now it's a bit of a chicken and an egg situation, isn't it, Dorcas? Because the South Africans are talking about needing $3 billion. You've got to find that money. Sure. Yeah. In order to find that money, you've got to attract investors. True. But many investors are turned off because of the lack of electricity, because they're thinking, well, why would I go and invest in this place where there is no electricity? So how do you get around that?
No, Charles, I think we need to look at different options of energy. You know, what we haven't done in Africa is look at different options of energy. There are models of development in Africa that are doing really, really, really well, which we need to borrow ideas from. Rwanda, for instance, is doing well. Right across the board, economically, the civil society is rising, health and education is rising, and they are bringing in what works at grassroots level. The problem with having all these power cuts and all other wider problems is that society is becoming more and more divided. When you move around Johannesburg, you're aware of how much money is in Johannesburg. Mm. It's quite a lot of money. You move into the outskirts, into the ghettos, and it's a very disturbing sight. So it's government commitment. Some of these options that we're looking at don't necessarily cost a lot of money. It's really about, there's room for discussion for privatization. Should we bring in privatization? Because what privatization does is free up the government so that they can concentrate on other pressing issues.
I think that makes a lot of sense, actually, because if you look at, for instance, Nigeria had the biggest privatization exercise in the history of Africa in the power sector. Sure. And that appears to be the only option for offering some sort of change. You sell off the place, people can see there's a huge potential for making money. They look at the telecommunications industry and see how much money the MTNs and the Globacoms and all that have made out of Nigeria, and they think this is a logical way forward.
Yes, and the template of what happened in the telecommunication is now being transposed into the energy sector, and a lot of people, Nigerians, are now demanding more in terms of electricity, and I think that is the next approach, and it's about looking at different approaches in terms of different energy sources. We know Ethiopia, we know they've used electric. And so there are different ways in which energy could be generated. And I think what matters now is about having those policies, having those strategy, and having enough investment to match it in order to provide that energy.
Okay, stay with us here on Talking Africa. After the break, we'll be hearing about the growing calls for some of Mali's most precious artifacts to be returned to Timbuktu.
Wherever and whatever your banking needs, Guarantee Trust Bank will be there now and into the future. Because you're at the heart of everything we do. Guarantee Trust Bank, proudly African, truly international.
You're watching Talking Africa here on Arise News with me, Charles Eniagolu, an hour of conversation about Africa with the best experts on Africa. And we're very glad to have the two of them here with us this evening. To Mali now, where 2 years ago, a large number of manuscripts were taken from Timbuktu to prevent them from being destroyed by Islamist rebels who'd taken over the city. Well, now the fighting is over and the city has been reclaimed. The question is being asked whether it's time for the manuscripts to be returned. Julie Jameau has this report.
Retreating Islamist rebels set fire to two libraries containing ancient manuscripts as French and Malian troops retook the Malian city of Timbuktu in January 2013. Cushioning the blow of this enormous loss was a discovery that thousands of these priceless manuscripts had already been rescued by local families keen to protect their cultural heritage. The manuscripts were smuggled out to the capital, Bamako, where earlier this year a conference was held to exhibit some of the surviving pieces dating from the 16th century.
Ils sont le témoignage d'une université qui a atteint son âge d'or.
They are the testimony of a university that reached its golden age during the 16th century, the University of Sankore, where there were great scholars. People came from everywhere, all over the world, to study at Timbuktu. These manuscripts, which are written in Arabic, for the most part, are a wealth of intellectual knowledge that can teach us a lot about our humanity, not just about Mali or African history, but our humanity.
Sur notre humanité, pas simplement sur le Mali ni sur l'histoire de l'Afrique, mais sur notre humanité.
Of the small proportion of manuscripts that have been studied so far, topics include religion, jurisprudence, optics, and even conflict resolution.
The idea is to find out the contents of these manuscripts, to digitize and make the best possible use of them, because it's true that it constitutes our wealth in Mali, but it's also a global richness.
Having survived the insurgency, the precious texts are now facing another threat, the climate. The manuscripts are at risk of rapid deterioration due to the high humidity of the capital, leading conference participants to call for an emergency plan to optimize their storage conditions. Nearly 28,000 manuscripts are stored at the Ahmed Baba Institute, one of the buildings that had been set ablaze. And a project initiated in Timbuktu to digitize the collection is being continued in temporary premises in Bamako. The institute director is looking forward to the day they will return to their original location.
It's a duty to return the manuscripts to Timbuktu, an obligation. One day we'll have to return to Timbuktu. But when? That's the question. We must first restore the premises to make sure they are suitable to receive these manuscripts. They also need to have maximum security.
Meanwhile, in Timbuktu, four libraries are currently being restored. But with the backdrop of the ongoing conflict in the north, the future is far from secure for the return of these ancient manuscripts.
Well, ancient treasures and rightful homes. There are some pretty fierce debates on this subject across the globe. And here to take a closer look at some of those issues are my guests, Dorcas Guata and Temitope Olode. Dorcas, do you think these precious, historically significant objects should be returned?
I think they should be returned once the region is stable. Mali is fighting different wars here. The Boko Haram crisis has spilled into the region. You need a degree of stability before you can bring them back. They are extremely valuable. They're attached to the tourism, for the Mali's tourism, which is hugely attached to the economy. So I think they absolutely would need to be returned. What shouldn't happen is they shouldn't be shipped over to the West and then end up in a museum where we end up paying £20 to go and see them. Yeah. That would be atrocious.
Do you think the longer they stay away, the less likely it is that they're going to be returned? Given past history.
I'm hoping that we have a different, we're in a different time now, and most of the people involved in these are educated enough, accessible enough to know that they will have a proper MOU on how these issues are being managed. You know, you keep it for us for some time, or we lend it to you for some time. We know libraries across the world lend things to each other.
Sure.
But what has happened over the centuries in Africa is that things have been taken away from Africa, and Africans have to pay to see those things. So we hope this is not the case. You know, these manuscripts are important. You know, they're rich about our culture and about who we are as a people.
But is there a business deal that could be done that where, for instance, I mean, you've got a country like Mali, it's been taken away, and, you know, it's like, okay, well, we don't know when stability is going to return to the region, and everyone agrees, as you correctly pointed out, that it's not good to take it back. Could you say, right, okay, put it in the French Museum, you know, and we'll split the tape sort of thing that comes from it.
And then we go into 25 years of a lawsuit between Mali and France, and then they will never be returned. I think it's a very good suggestion, but let's find a happy medium. Let's use African capability. Too often we look at the West as though that, you know, template and model is actually the best. Within Africa, there's a lot of capability. Just outside those regions are fully functioning countries.
Yep.
They could absolutely step in. Mm. What it does is go a long way to strengthen our collaboration as Africans. I do wish sometimes the African Union had a wider role, because really, this is a platform and an institution that should be addressing wider issues.
That's a very interesting point, Temitope, because, yep. We just talked about African treasures being looted for hundreds of years.
Yes.
But if you took this model that's being suggested, tourism is a vital, you know, yes, income source,
yes,
for countries like Kenya, yeah, South Africa, that sort of thing. I mean, it is possible that you could do this deal with them where these manuscripts and all that are kept there and displayed. At least the money is coming back to Africa, and yeah, part of that could trickle back to Mali.
Yes, I totally agree, because currently the inter-trading within Africa stands at about between 10 to 12%. Mm-hmm. Now, I think it's time for, you know, business within Africa for Africans and by Africans. And I think that is what I subscribe to, that, to their ideology. And I think it's good, because I know, based on my understanding and what we know and what we've read, that if only Africa could just develop its tourism industry, more than 50,000 people could be employed in that industry. Most of these energetic youth that know about their culture will be able to talk about it. They could be tour guides. They could, you know, ride by, you know, buses and things like that. So I totally agree with that ideology that we need to keep these things within Africa and find a way around ensuring that the culture stays in.
On the other hand, of course, I suspect that if you took a poll of ordinary people in Africa, their priority isn't going to be a museum and going to sort of look at arts and that sort of thing. Their priority is just going to be elsewhere. I mean, should the government be following those pressing needs and priorities rather than talking about art and, you know, museums and that sort of thing?
And not just government. Every one of us has a role in enhancing the arts and culture industries in Africa. It just doesn't get priority. One thing Africans are very keen on is education. So if you tie your arts and culture development to education, there you've got a growth of people who are interested in developing these industries. You know, we look too much to the West. You have people listening to Lady Gaga and, you know, Kim Kardashian and, you know, modeling these kind of sort of characters in the West who are way removed from their everyday lives. So we could go a long way to develop that.
Do you think you've been living in the West too long? Because the honest truth is that if you look, for example, Nigerian music is dominating the African continent, South African music.
Sure.
If you go to a lot of clubs in London, you're going to hear Oliver Twist being played and, you know, and songs like that, and young kids really getting into it. So I don't think that suggestion, I mean, I do agree with you that certainly there is this overarching prevalence of Western culture within Africa. But I also think that Africans are doing quite a lot to move things forward. What do you reckon?
I believe that it's just an issue of rebranding Africa. Before, Africa is more like a jungle, that if you want to go there, people live on the trees. It's not like that. If you go to places like South Africa, if you go to places like Abuja, if you go to places like Accra, people know that you will find more Rolls Royce in those places than anywhere else in the world. So I think it's about reselling ourselves, rebranding ourselves. You know, the way it's been sold in the past is not right. When I was growing up, you know, we listened to more Western music. Now the Americans, the British are going back to Africa because we have the population, we have those youths who are hungry for music, and our guys are now doing it better even now. So I totally agree with the fact that it's more about rebranding Africa.
Never mind, I'll take you somewhere you can listen to Africa.
I'm outnumbered, totally outnumbered.
Well, time now for another very short break, but do please stay with us on Talking Africa. When we come back, we'll be talking about the work of the Gabonese cartoonist Patrick Essono and asking whether the pen is mightier than the sword in bringing Africa's elite to book over abuses and corruption.
There is a reason Africa is called the new frontier. What was once potential is now an opportunity ready to be seized. Once revered for our resources, today's wealth lies in our people, people who build the cities that shape the future. People who know an idea in one place means business in another. A generation for whom technology means there are no borders, no boundaries. We are the new lions in a brave new world, kings of the urban jungle. And there's a bank that puts the world in our pocket and the future in our hands. UBA, Africa's global bank.
The best way to predict the future is to create it. There's a special breed of achievers out there called tomorrow's people. They imagine what will be and strive to make it happen. They refuse to wait for the future. Tomorrow bends and conforms to their ideas. At Access Bank, we share the same sentiments. Our mantra for success is simple: speed, service, and security. Tomorrow's people own the future because they keep the world turning. That is the power of taking tomorrow.
You're watching Talking Africa with me, Charles Aniagolu, an hour of African conversation every week here on Arise News. If it matters in Africa, we'll be talking about it right here. What we're talking about right now is the Gabonese cartoonist and comic book author Patrick Essono. The 44-year-old, known as Pahe, caricatures those in power, those in opposition, and the social conventions around him. And as James Rice reports, it's made him very popular in his home country.
Patrick Essono's pen has brought him global notoriety. The Gabonese satirical caricaturist known as Pahe expresses and criticizes the political and social situation in his country.
My comic book tells the story of the 5 years in power of Ali Bongo Ondimba, who I call the King of Gabon. It's a compilation of all my best drawings from 2009 to 2015.
Irreverent, sometimes rude, but still courted by power, Pahe's latest book features Gabon's president wearing a tiny golden crown on the cover.
He is
the king of the Gabonese Republic, my king, my majesty, and loyal subject that I am, I couldn't help but bow down before him and make a book about him. Doing a cover with Ali Bongo sends your sales through the roof. I am above all an artist. I make books, so they sell.
Pahe is a fervent critic of President Ali Bongo Ondimba, who won elections in August 2009 after the death of his father, Omar Bongo. The polls were followed closely by clashes between police and supporters of aggrieved rivals who said the election was fraudulent. After the announcement of Bongo's win, Pahe was reported to have said Gabon had become a monarchy, a company owned by Bongo.
Je pense qu'il va loin, mais la sa façon d'aller loin ne.
I think he can take things far, but in a way that doesn't think about consequences. You have to be relevant to move forward. You have to know how to laugh. You need humour and to know not to take things too seriously. And being able to laugh at a situation helps you to see things more clearly.
As a satirist, he's not surprised by the number of politicians and officials that are not too happy about his work. In a country where freedom of expression is controlled and the media is constantly under the watch of the National Council of Communication, Pahe says his intention is to make his audience laugh at themselves. James Wright, Arise News.
Well, the work of Patrick Essono there, poking fun at those in power. And of course, across Africa, more and more people are finding ways to challenge their leaders' decisions and question the status quo. With me are my guests, Dorcas Guata and Temitope Olode. Is the pen mightier than the sword, Dorcas? Is that the impression that certainly that's being conveyed by that video?
You know, whatever happened to a great sense of humor? If things are funny, they're just funny. But there's a balancing act to be had. With the question about freedom of speech, the pen, you know, what is right and what isn't, the jury's out and will be out for quite a long time. But what we have absurdly around the world is a disproportional reaction to the pen. We have the pen, and then people laugh, and then a few people think, well, this is outrageous, and somebody ends up in jail for 10 years. Mm. Well, where is the proportionality? It's just absolutely incredible. I think he's very brave to be doing that in Africa. It's an awful lot of paranoia in politics. It's an awful lot of paranoia in Africa. And for him to take a pen and draw his president, I think is a brave, very brave man.
I suppose it depends on the country that you're in, doesn't it?
Yeah, definitely it does. And I think what is happening now is that...
You wouldn't do that in Zimbabwe, would you? It wouldn't be recommended.
It wouldn't be recommended. And I think the more democratic some African countries become, the more they loosen up in terms of, you know, letting go certain things.
Yeah, you can probably get away with it in South Africa.
Yes.
And you can certainly get away with it in Nigeria, because Nigeria has the most disputatious press. and they've made their stock in trade is actually attacking, I mean, quite robustly, the government and on all people in office.
And people like to read it, and people want it. And this is where people strive on that. And I think there is a balance. I think because we're Africans and, you know, we do things differently, there is always a level that we do not go beyond. We know when to stop, you know, because we're trained to be more respectful to elders. We're trained to respect authorities. We're trained not to, you know, cause annoyance. So we know where to stop. You know, we push it a bit, but we don't go beyond.
So I suppose what really he's talking about is self-censorship, isn't it?
It is, and he completely nails it. But all this reflects, really, what this reflects is the wider government issues. How relaxed is a government? If a government is absolutely, it cannot take a joke, then, you know, that reflects and is speaking to the wider issues happening around the country. You name a few countries who just absolutely would not tolerate that. But we have to find a balancing act. Absolutely need to find a balancing act.
I suppose the question, of course, is, as we said, it depends on the country. Yes. And as she said, a lot of these guys are not amused, especially when what you're saying is actually hitting home. In other words, there are nuggets and rather large elements of truth in it.
Yes, and when you look at it across Africa, you could actually divide it into two sides, north and south. And we've seen within the last at least few months and years, we've seen what is happening in the northern part of
Egypt,
Nigeria,
for example.
Egypt, Algeria, where, you know, people are picked up and thrown in jail and given ridiculous sentences. And then you have places like Nigeria or down south, you know, where, you know, people continue to do these things, and, you know, it's like, just ignore them. You know, it will go away if you start ignoring it, or people just laugh over it. You know, so I think it's getting that balance. And I think what we're having more now is that even the self-censorship by, you know, some of our African artists and cartoonists.
And that's one of the things people are saying, that they don't want to see, or that those who don't want to see General Buhari in Nigeria take office.
Yes,
they're saying that the man is humorless. He doesn't smile. He's very austere. There's something of the knight about him, sort of thing. Something quite spooky. And this is the guy, I mean, Jonathan, you can get away with anything. There's not one single political prisoner or prisoner of conscience or whatever in any Nigerian jail. Yeah. But you're more likely to see that if General Buhari comes into power.
Oh, you know, the guy has a sense of humor. You know, I saw him today and he cracked a few jokes. But listen, this is the face of a country. This becomes, this person who's now being, you know, cartooned, becomes the face of the country. And so it's like an open door into somebody's house. And does it reflect us well or not? I think we should loosen up a bit. What we have in Africa, I come very strongly from a cultural point of view, is this idea that people who are in power are therefore revered and therefore almost untouchable and removed away from, you know, from the ordinary person. What cartoons do is make, you know, everyday lives real. Mm. They make that, you know, they crack a joke out of everyday lives. So, you know, we've got to remove this idea that age and power in Africa is revered as something that is that, you know, that divides one person to the other. I really, really like these jokes because they make every day. Wouldn't it be great if we could read about Buhari, you know, eating a burger in you know, High Street Lagos or something?
I suppose it's a dual problem, isn't it, in Africa? Because you've got she talks about the people being revered, you know, the sort of the elders and all that sort of thing. But at the same time, you've also got that almost post-Soviet or pre-sort of Soviet Union type of developmental journalism, where, you know, the media were expected to be a cooperating part of the national establishment.
Yes, it is. And we know that politicians have tried, you know, not just Nigeria alone, but to try and buy the journalists on their side, cartoonists on their side. And we've had government officials say, oh, you know, you shouldn't be doing this, you should be supporting it, especially on the war on terrorism in Nigeria. We know that this gentleman that is looking at becoming the next president is talking about what he will do. He's talking about coming up with a summit on how to address security. And we're hoping that anybody that gets in, whoever gets in, will address the issue of security properly and use the appropriate skill set to address it.
Okay, and a final word from you, Dorcas.
I'd like to see more cartoonists, just making everyday lives, not just about people in power, by the way, but every woman going to the market, let's make a cartoon out of it. We don't have enough jokes around. I think it'd be great to have that.
Okay. Dorcas Gwata and Temi Tope Olodo, thank you very much indeed. And that is it from us for now. My thanks to my guests, as I mentioned there, Dorcas Gwata and Temi Tope Olodo, for their insights and opinions. We return every night here on Africa Wrap at 1800 GMT. For now, from me, Charles Onyegulu, and from the entire team here in London, thank you very much indeed for watching.